यस्मात् जातं जगत् सर्वं यस्मिन् एव प्रलीयते येनेदं धार्यते चैव तस्मै ज्ञानात्मने नमः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः तैत्तिरीयकसारस्य मयाचार्यप्रसादतः विस्पष्टार्थरुचीनां हि व्याख्येयं संप्रणीयते ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषा वहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः सो लास्ट क्लास वी सा द एलिमेंट्स ऑफ विज्ञानमय कोश विच इज द fourth layer in the panchakosha, which is part of the Brahmanandavalli. Just to recollect, it says tasya shraddaye vashiraha, the central theme of vijnana. The central theme of vijnana is shraddha, and we discussed it in great detail. Without Shraddha, knowledge will never accrue. In Bhagavad Gita also we saw Shraddhavan Labhate Jnanam. So without Shraddha it is not going to work. Now why this is so emphasized is in spiritual journey don't bring signs. It's an utter waste of time. None of the things that we talk in spirituality can be verified, can be, you can use the laws of signs and try to do anything. That is why Shraddha is the most important raw material in spiritual journey, which makes strict proof unnecessary, and it is Guru Vakya. That's what in Viveka Chudamani the definition is. It is Guru Vakya and what Shruti says. If we are not able to hold on to this, this flight will never run on the runway, leave alone taking off. So that is why Shraddha is emphasized in a great way in Vijnanamaya Kosha. So it is like saying we cannot repair a high pressure boiler which is leaking with a set of gadgets for fixing some electronic instrument. It's just not going to work. Let's not bring science into spirituality, because science is meant for the world outside. Spirituality is meant for the world inside. Those rules are very different. Laws of gravity doesn't work. None of the, it is not law of conservation of mass, but it is law of conservation of divinity. Same rule. It only says divinity can neither be created nor be destroyed. It can only transform from one form to another. So that is why Shraddha is a very, very important component in our preparation to. So that's what we saw. Which we could not see last class, so we will see that. But before doing that, a few thoughts I wanted to add. from the Annamaya Kosha, we have come to the last kosha. Today we look at the Anandamaya Kosha. As we progress, it is getting subtler and subtler. Annamaya Kosha is the stula. Every one of us are able to see us. 6 feet, so much weight and thickness, color of the skin, everything we can see. So from this grass, as we move into subtle, what happens is, I want you to reflect on that. In every one of them, it says there is a pucham. In this proverb, this bird description, the support is the tail. So if you look at, the pucham is becoming different and different. I will, this is like this. If there is a specs, I can own the specs. I can say this is my specs. If there is a pen, I can say this is my pen. If there is a shirt, I can say this is my shirt. I mean, even that may not make too much sense, but at least I can do that because it is stula. Please tell me, how am I going to say this cool air is mine? The point is, as it becomes sukshma, you have to relate this air to the larger principle of air. You know, at a very high level of thinking, I may relate this piece of spectacle to a larger piece of spectacle, but at least when it is stula, I am able to say this is my specs. But I cannot definitely say this is my air. The cool air that we are blessed with, I don't think I can say just because I built a house, this air belongs to me. That is what is being indicated here. So the first two puchas are related to the body. Look at from the Manomaya Kosha. In Manomaya Atma, it said, Atarvangirasa Pucham Pratishta. It actually said Atarva and Angirasa, the two rishis who created the Atarva Veda. It said how the mind picks up the knowledge from there, so the support for that is now outside. It's available everywhere. If you look at Vijnanamaya Kosha, Mahapucham Pratishta, the great intellect. So every intellect borrows from the great intellect. As much as every air that flows in any enclosure owned by anybody is part of this larger scheme of air, that idea is coming. Today we will see in Anandamaya, it says Brahma Pucham Pratishta. All forms of happiness originate from a repository of happiness called Brahma. So that is what is showing that it is getting subtler and subtler. From Annamaya Kosha, it goes up to Anandamaya Kosha, it is getting subtler and subtler slowly. I wanted to just share this thought before we go. So we'll see the upasana of the Vijnanamaya Kosha. Vijnanam yajnam tanute karmani tanute picha vijnanam deva sarve brahma jeshtam upasate vijnanam brahma ched veda tasmachena pramadyati sharire papmano hitva sarvan kaman samashnuta iti tasyaisha eva sharira atma yapurvasya. So this is the upasana pala of Vijnanamaya Kosha or Vijnanamaya Atma. So it says, Vijnanam yajnam tanute, karmani tanute apicha. So it says, it is Vijnanam which makes the yajna possible, the activity called yajna possible. Karmani tanute apicha, all vyavaharika karmas. So there are two here, yajnam is one reference here. Karmani tanute apicha, there is a reference of karma. So essentially what it is saying is all the activities that we engage in this world, all the activities that we engage in, whether it is shrauta, smartha, that kind of karmas, or it is dainandinika, vyavaharika, whichever way we see it, whatever work we are involved in, it says it is actually enabled by knowledge. It is performed by knowledge. I mean, as we know, these Upanishads are all written in a very metaphorical, and so knowledge performs is not knowledge performs. Essentially, knowledge is the basis we perform. So that idea is being communicated here. So knowledge is extreme, presupposes any action. And so if you look at Lalita Sahasranama, Look at the three mantras. It says Ichha Shakti, Jnana Shakti, Kriya Shakti. That order can never be altered. Don't try to alter. First desire, the desire, and before you engage into action, we need knowledge. With buddhi as the nearest reference that we can put into our antahkarana. So there are a couple of ideas which we need to understand when this statement is made by the Shruti. Only when someone is self-composed. See, knowledge, now the question is, how does knowledge actually accrue? So only when someone is self-composed by the practice of meditation, that faith, etc., enabled. So faith, while it is required, but there is this state of mind which should be at peace. That's very, very important. So without that, it is not going to happen. That's the first thing. So this, in order for the jnana to happen, we need a peace of mind. That's why manomaya kosha is a prerequisite for a vijnanamaya kosha. That's how it is coming. And we all know, intellect is, at the end of the day, intellect is the agent of everything intelligently done in the world. The seat of that is the intellect. So that is the vijnanam, yajnam tanute, karmani tanute apicha, is actually trying to. And without that correct knowledge. So it's a very simple idea, whether it is the daily work and this management and all other things that we do, or whether we're talking about the ultimate knowledge we want to get and kind of activities we have to engage in. It's very clear that if we are not able to accumulate the right knowledge, then the action is futile. At the end of the day, action becomes futile. It becomes meaningless. It becomes fruitless. That is why to say that knowledge performs all actions, essentially what it is trying to communicate is the right knowledge only makes the effort worthwhile in terms of the quality of the effort, in terms of the fruits that we get and so on. So that is what is being communicated by saying knowledge performs all sacrifices. It is a real agent of all physical activities and so on. That's what it says. And therefore it says, Vijnanam Deva Sarve Brahma Jyeshtam Upasate. So this upasana in this Vijnanamaya Kosha is contemplate on this superior knowledge which we are blessed with as Brahman itself. Because that is ahead of everything that we do and in whatever journey we go. Brahma Jyeshtam Upasate. In fact, lots of commentaries on this. The Brahman that is being related to this is Hiranyagarbha. And there is a nice Hiranyagarbha Sukta in Rigveda. It's the first mantra itself, it says, Hiranyagarbha Samavartatagre Bhutasya Jatapatireka Asit. That's the first thing it says. Ahead of everything, Bhutasya Jatasya Bhutasya Patihi Eka Eva Asit. That's what he says. It is the Sutratman. That is the word used in Vedanta. That is the thread with which the whole creation started. The Hiranyagarbha is the thread with which the whole creation process started. That's why it says Brahma Jyeshtam Upasate. So the detailed commentary that many people give is the Brahman that is being talked about here, the Upasana Devata here is Hiranyagarbha. And Hiranyagarbha is ahead of all sorts of creation that one can imagine. That's the first manifestation. But in the next mantra, it will say, So kamayata bahut syam praja ye yeti satapo tapyata satapas taptu. All that will come in the next mantra. How the whole creation process started? It started with the Hiranyagarbha. So that is being indicated here. That's why it says, Vijnanam Brahma Ched Veda. If we understand this knowledge as the Brahman, if you do upasana on this knowledge as the Brahman, then what will happen? And tasmat chet na pramadyeti. You don't swerve from there. You are single-pointedly focusing on this idea that the ultimate pure knowledge is the manifestation of Brahman at one level of contemplation. If you are able to fix our understanding in that very seriously, then the Shruti says, Sharire papmano hitva sarvan kaman samashnu samyak ashnuta. That individual, that is upasana pala that is being indicated here. It says, contemplate on knowledge as a proxy for Brahman. So I want to remind this again and again to you. This whole panchakosha is the tatastha lakshana. It is difficult to point the Brahman. It is very difficult for me to show a house. So what I will say, there is a coconut tree. Are you seeing a coconut tree? Yes. After the coconut tree, do you see a yellow color painting? Yes. The second house from that, that is the house. That is what Shruti is doing. It cannot show Brahman, because Brahman cannot be shown. Brahman can be shown only with tatastha. So it shows the Annamaya, then it showed it to Pranamaya. Then it is like saying, go take a turn. There is a, it's now showing the coconut. Or we have come very close. When it comes to Vijnanamaya and Anandamaya, it is taking us closer. So these are all to be contemplated in right earnest, because that clarifies some ideas about one level of understanding of what is this ultimate truth that we are going after. So a person who is able to do that, the Upasana Pala says, Sharire Papmano Hitva. It says you will be devoid of all sins. Why? Because what is the central issue? The central issue is all sins begin with identification of the self with the body. Most of the sins start there. That is why, one person went to Ramana Maharishi. This is a Telugu person. This is part of his thing I have read. And he had two twin daughters. Cute, four-year-old. So sometimes the kids pick up these ideas so well. We have no idea how they pick up. So one of the daughter will keep on repeating something which apparently Ramana Maharishi said sometime. What is that? This girl always says, Deham, Naham, Koham, Soham. It's a very profound idea. Deham, Naham. I am not the body. Then comes Koham. Kaha Aham. Who am I? Saha Aham, Soham. So, Deham, Naham, Koham, Soham. This small phrase essentially points to this idea which is told here. Lots of our sins are because of Deha Abhimana. These three fundamental truths very difficult to pass through. I am not the body. Sometimes it is little easy to do it. The body is not mine. That's the second version of the first statement. I am not the body is very different from saying the body is not mine. The third truth is the body is not for me. If people can cross that, this contemplation can help us. That knowledge can help us to cross. That is why he says, Sharire Papmano Hitva. Contemplation of the knowledge is the only way by which one can get out of this too much of attachment. In chapter 12 of Bhagavad Gita, when Arjuna asked about Saguna and Nirguna, first two shlokas, Krishna talked about Saguna Upasana. In the fourth shloka, he said, Kleshaha Adhikataraha Tesham Avyakta Sakta Chesasam. That's what he said. This Nirguna Upasana is not easy. Avyakta bir gatir dukkam dehavad bihi abhijayate. We are all very body oriented, body conscious people. For us, Nirguna Upasana is difficult. And how will we go there? This contemplation will help us. Contemplating on the power of ultimate knowledge and thinking, getting that knowledge is as good as getting the ultimate truth, will distance us from the body. Will keep body to a level that we need to keep. Our body consciousness can come down. That is what is being indicated by this saying, Sharire Papmano Hitva Sarvan Kaman Samashnute. So that person will be able to partake all that is required as part of carrying on this mortal body until we have to drop it. It will be done with a sense of detached attachment. Attachment because the prakriti requires that it has to be maintained. Prakriti requires that it needs to play its role. Detachment because we are not worried about the pluses and minuses of what is happening around it. That is the way Sarvan Kaman Samashnuta Iti. So that is what is being indicated here. Then it says, as we it said in all the previous mantras, it said tasya. Tasya means the previous one, which is vijnanamaya kosha. Vijnanamaya koshasya. Yeshaha eva sharira. That becomes sharira, this becomes sharira or shariri. The one which occupies that cavity is this. So now it says you replace vijnanamaya, now you bring, you know, you replace manomaya and bring vijnanamaya as the reality. That's what it is saying. Yah purvasya, like it has been told in all the koshas, it is being repeated once again. Now I want to spend a little more time on this knowledge, because we spent a lot of time on manas in manomaya kosha. Now let us spend a little bit time on knowledge. Bhagavad Gita chapter 4, wonderfully it closed with 12 beautiful shlokas on knowledge. The ultimate ideas on knowledge, I always say, let us draw only from the 12 shlokas. 33rd shloka to 42nd shloka. Wonderful shloka is in Bhagavad Gita chapter 4, where all ideas about knowledge which is relevant to this Vijnanamaya kosha. And then Viveka Chudavani, I want to quote a couple of shlokas, which are all saying why we should be worried about Vijnanam. What happens when we go after Vijnana? So on Viveka Chudamani, it says, Ajnana Yoga Paramatmanaha Tava Hi Anatma Bandaha Tatayeva Samsrutihi Tayoho Viveka Udito Bodha Vannihi Ajnana Karyam Pradahet Samulam. So he says, because of Ajnana, or Yoga is Jnana, Jnana Yoga, it's Ajnana Yoga. Because of Ajnana Yoga, this Paramatman is camouflaged now. This ultimate truth is a little camouflaged and it creates this bondage. It says Anatma Bandhu. This Atma gets attached to the Anatman because of Ajnana. So that's what the first line says. Ajnana Yogat Paramatmanaha Tavahi Anatma Bandhu Tatayeva Samsrutihi. Then the second line he says Tayoho. These two, Atman and Anatman, are now together. That's why the Tayoho is coming. And Viveka Udita Bodha Vanhihi. The Jnanagni, the manifestation of knowledge, which is being equated to the fire of knowledge, what it will do? It will remove these out of the two, it will remove the Ajnana Karyam. This Avarna that we are going through will be burnt. It says Pradahet Samulam. To the last part, it will completely burn it. In fact, in Bhagavad Gita, it says Jnanagni Dagdaha. In chapter 4 only, it talks about Jnanagni Dagdaha. The 19th shloka, there is a description of Jnanagni Dagdaha comes 2-3 places in Bhagavad Gita. Then he says, look at the next shloka. It says Ajnana Sarpa. There is the serpent called Ajnana. Ajnana Sarpa Dashtasya, one who is bitten by the snake called Ajnana, right? Brahmajnana Aushadam Vina, without the ultimate knowledge of Brahmajnana, what can we do with the others? The second line gives all other alternatives. It says, Kimu Vedaischa Shastraicha, Kimu Mantraihi, Kimu Aushadaihi. Of what avail with all these, unless that ultimate knowledge Spurana happens. That's very, very important. That ultimate knowledge must manifest. So this Vijnanamaya Kosha, contemplating as knowledge as Brahman, we should relate to that ultimate knowledge, not the lower levels of knowledge, because that is the only one which can destroy this avarna called Ajnana. So that's why he says, what is the use of Veda and Shastra if at the end of it we are not getting the Brahman Jnanam through that? They are only a vehicle. With that, what can we do? Is what he is actually asking in this. So this, no, if you look at in Bhagavad Gita, look at chapter 2, look at the 43rd shloka, even look at chapter 11, after the Vishwarupa Darshana, Krishna says two beautiful things to Arjuna. He says, Veda, Yajna, Yajna, Dana, all that, with that you cannot reach me. In other words, again I'll give you an example. One person went to Ramana Maharishi. Today only Ramana Maharishi examples are coming. One fellow went to Ramana Maharishi. He said, Swamiji, I have been reading this Bhagavad Gita for the last 20 years. Nothing is happening. So Shastra and Veda that is being told here is all the knowledge. Ramana Maharishi said, you have been looking at the book is saying look at you are not looking at you. In other words, knowledge is from jnana we have to go to vijnana. So these are all only a conduit. Brahmajnanam will happen, this can only catalyze the process. So the point he is making here is, mere knowledge is only a necessary condition, not a sufficient condition to get the realization. So that is what is being indicated here. Everywhere it is there. Absolutely. Then, end of Veka Chudamani, Veka Chudamani ends with a few concluding shlokas, in which there is one shloka. It says, Pashana, Vriksha, Trina, Dhanya, Kata, Ambaradhyaha. So, Adi is etel. So, he has put some 5-6 examples. Pashana, which is stone, Vriksha, right, a tree, then Trina, which is grass, Dhanya, some kind of a sasya, then Kata, which is a mat, and Ambara, some cloth. Adihi, Adhyaha, Etel, ... Okay. Dagda Bhavantihi Mrideva Yaya Yata Tataiva Yaya Tataiva. Just like Yaya is a Sri Linga which talks about Agni. So just like a fire can actually burn all of them into soft looking clay. Mridu, nice powder. How all of them lose their name, shape, everything. It's all Advaita at the end of the day. All names and shapes are all reduced to a single entity called, probably a gray color powdered ash. So all of them become soft. In the same way, Dehendriyasu, Mana, Adi, Samasta, Drishyam. So all these Kshetra, all the detailed description of Kshetra that you see in 13th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, all those 24 items plus, all of them, Jnanagni daktam upayati. Once the fire of knowledge really burns all of them, burns in the sense, they become immaterial. Only when that feeling comes, that doesn't mean the body gets burnt, it becomes irrelevant. Then sharire papmano hitva will happen. That is the state of sharire papmano hitva which we saw in the Shruti. So sharire papmano hitva means the deha abhimana, the consciousness about the body will be removed. Body is not removed. None of those are removed. But the abhimana is removed. That is what is being done. And then paramatma bhavam will come. So that's what he concludes in Viveka Chudamani and all this. As I told you, Bhagavad Gita last 12 shlokas in chapter 4 particularly, although I have taken Jnana Karma Sannyasa Yoga. So everything about Jnana should be there. So I have taken the most important things from chapter 4 of Bhagavad Gita. He says, this is the 10th shloka. He says, Vitaraga Bayakroda Manmayamam Upashitaha Bhagavaha Jnana Tapasa Puta Madbhavam Agataha. He says, through Jnana Tapas, lot of people have come unto me. So it is not an ivory tower idea. He says, many have come through Jnana Yajna, Jnana Tapas. So that is the first reference in the chapter on Jnana, in 10th. Then this Jnanagni Daktaha Tamahu Panditam Budaha, I told in the 19th shloka. So, fired by the, burnt by the fire of knowledge, they become pure. That's what, the wise people, the realized people say. And then he talks a little later. He says, Atma Samyama Yoga Agnau Jukhvati Jnana Deepite. There are 5 types of yajnas, in which this is one of them. In chapter 3, the yajnas are of one variety. In chapter 4, it takes it to a much higher level, the discussion of yajna. So he talks about Atma Samyama Yoga Agnau Jukhvati Jnana Deepite. So the altar is the Atma, self-control. In that self-control, you actually, make the ahuti and then the light of knowledge. There is a spurti of the light of knowledge. That's what is being talked about in that shloka. Then, of course, Sarva karma kilam partha jnane parisamapyati. All action must eventually lead to knowledge. So earlier we are saying knowledge is required for the action. Now here it is saying sarva karmakilam jnane parisamapite. What it means is the vijnana. Out of knowledge you do an action. Out of action you get a realized knowledge. It's a much more higher level of knowledge. So that is what is being indicated here. So that is what it is here. Of course, how do you acquire knowledge? You know, tadviddhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti te jnanam jnanina tattva darshana. That is also part of this chapter. And there are so many things as to what happens when one acquires knowledge. They are all available in this chapter in about 10 slokas. 33 to 42, you'll find everything. For example, the 31st shloka says, Yena Bhutan Aseshena Drakshesi. That Samya Bhava, that vision goes to a very different plane for a person who has a superior knowledge which manifested in him or her. So that is what he says there. Then what will action do? What will a good knowledge do? It says, Sarva Karmani Basmasat Kurunandana. That is a shloka. It says, all actions are burnt. What does it mean? It means all effects coming out of actions are burnt. Actions are not going to bother people anymore. That is the acid test for superior knowledge. When we get experience in grey matter, that is what we mean even in the narrow sense. Things don't bother me much more, which means I have collected enough grey matter. As much as it bothered 20 years back. That is what is being indicated, and that we can take it to the ultimate knowledge also. So that's what it says. Then of course this axiomatic statement, Nahi jnaneena sadrisham pavitramiha vidyate. Nothing can be purer than knowledge. And the interesting part about this knowledge is all these are to a large extent applicable in aparavidya. In our day-to-day knowledge also we can relate this. All these can be related to paravidya also. This is the charm of some of these recommendations and ideas that we see here. All these are true even in our day-to-day things. Nahi jnaneena sadrisham pavitramiha vidyate. A person possessing a superior knowledge is very pricey today. So if that is the notion of pavitra in Vyavaharika, that is the meaning of pavitra. Or whatever you know we want to understand. Then shraddhavan labhate jnanam. Why shraddha is very important. That's why in vijnanamaya kosha, we said tasya shraddha eva shiraha. Shraddha eva shiraha. We said that. And then jnana plavanena eva vrijinam santarishyasi. We can cross the ocean of sins and our limitations only with knowledge. We don't have to go to very high level knowledge to understand it. A person who doesn't know how to write, he becomes literate, he crosses a certain limitation in his life. Simple. A person who gets some other knowledge crosses certain limitations. So you have to extend the logic up to this. So a person who gets Brahma Jnana will overcome all limitations, all constraints in life. All constraints that can ever put in front of you. So that is what it says by saying, Jnana plavena eva. With this boat called knowledge, only you can cross the ocean of sins. That's what it said. He ended the chapter with a beautiful shloka. Because it's a Jnana Karma Sannyasa Yoga, I took that shloka alone. Tasmat ajnana sambhutam hristam jnana asina atmanah. Chitva yenam samshayam yogam atishto tishta bharata. So he 31 shlokas he talked about knowledge. Then he ended the chapter with tasmat, therefore. Krishna said, therefore, he says, Hristam ajnana sambhutam, that ajnana which is inside, resident in you, what do? Jnana asina, use the sword of knowledge. Asi is a sword. Jnana asina, use the sword of knowledge. Chitva, cut it. Enam. Enam is the reference to the same thing the second time. So this ajnanam, right? Samshayam, all these doubts will perish. When you bring knowledge, doubts will go. That's why he said, Ashraddha ajnanascha samshayatma vinashyati. One who doesn't have knowledge will be a doubting Thomas. And he will perish. A doubting Thomas will perish, is what he said. Here you said, and then yogam atishto atishta. Get into the practice of yoga, armed with this knowledge. You have a clarity of purpose of your existence. Get into the practice of yoga, atishto atishta bharata. That's how he concluded chapter 4. where all these ideas of knowledge, I think these ideas are all to be mapped onto this upasana. So knowledge as Brahman is not a very casual idea. I think there is so much of the power that we are talking about, that is what is being reflected in this Vijnanamaya Kosha as it is being discussed here. And then there are a couple of references. Vai Sharire Papmano Hitva, these are nice references. Jnana Vijnana Yoga, which is chapter 7. So he started by saying, Jnanam Te Aham Savijnanamitam Vakshyami Aseshataha. I will tell you the jnana and the vijnana aspect of knowledge. Yat jnatva, having known that, naiha bhuyaha anyat jnatavyam avasishyate. Now or ever in the future, there is anything else to be known. Anyat jnatavyam na avasishyate. That is the power of knowledge. Knowledge is the ultimate purifier, ultimate resolver of every one of our confusions and constraints in life. That is what is being told. In chapter 9, in Raja Vidya, Raja Guhya also, he started the chapter by saying, Idam tute guhyatamam pravakshyami, pravakshyami anasuyave, jnana vijnana sahitam. Yat jnatva, having understood this whole notion of jnana and vijnana, mokshyase ashubhat. You will be relieved of ashubha, not shubha. All these limitations, all these constraints, all these mental problems that we are going through, you will go beyond that into a highway. That is why knowledge has to be celebrated as Brahman. And our ability to acquire knowledge is a function of our ability to say knowledge is Brahman. That will only catapult us to that level. That is why that upasana is being recommended. So with this, the discussion ends as far as Vijnanamaya Kosha is concerned. Then it moves on to Anandamaya Kosha, and a couple of thoughts before we actually look at that. If you look at Vijnanamaya Atma, it actually said Vijnanam Yajnam Tanute Sarvani Karmani Tanupeti Tanute Picha. Is that what it said? Right? So what it says, in some way, the Shruti is saying the self, which is usurped the role of agent through vijnana and intellect. The self identified with the vijnana and said, I am the agent now. That is what is indicated by saying all work is done by knowledge. And knowledge is a proxy for vijnanamaya. So this personality that we are now analyzing, this fourth personality called the layer of knowledge, has usurped the role of agent. Says, I am the agent. Because without knowledge, nothing happens. That's what we argued. Now, what is this self going to do in the next layer? It usurps the role of I am the enjoyer. So, kartritva it said through vijnanamaya. Now, boktritva it says, I am the boktritva. We all always say that. So, we have to explain that possibility. We take the kartritva and boktritva on us. How do we do it? So, the Shruti is explaining. The Vijnanamaya Kosha of the personality of ours, which actually enables the Kartritva Bhava. Because Vijnanam Yajnam Tanute, that's what it is. I am the agent. Through the intellect, I brought the knowledge and then directed the mind to do things. Because whatever the mind wants, the buddhi only resolves. And for the buddhi to resolve, you need all the knowledge. So that is how it usurped the role of the agent. Now in Anandamaya Kosha, the next kosha is Anandamaya Kosha, in which the self is saying, I will usurp the role of the enjoyer. Now enjoyer means not only positive, it also negative. There is a plus and minus. Although it talks about the Ananda. We talk about the positive part of it, but the self, which is actually pristine, clear. No, yes, padika is colorless. If you come and put a small yellow colored flower by the side of it, the spadika will become yellow. If you put a red color flower by the side of spadika, the spadika will become red. In the same way, this self, which is what we are searching with this tatastha, we are trying to go to the third street, fourth street, we have now peeled four layers. The more closer we go, the self is saying, I am actually a spadika, but if I join with buddhi, I become agent. In the same way, it says, now I will join with, you have another layer called Anandamaya Kosha. If I joined with Anandamaya Kosha, then I become the enjoyer of the fruits of action. That is what is being indicated by the fifth layer of the personality that we are seeing, which is the Anandamaya Kosha. So actually, look at how each kosha is much, much bigger and subtler than the other. Let us talk about Vijnanamaya Kosha, which we completed. How does it says I am the agent? If it has to become the agent, it needs the Annamaya, because the Stula Sharira is required to talk, to walk, to give, take, all that. So Annamaya is required. Pranamaya is required, because in Kannada they say Usiradu Beku. So the breath has to come and go. Only then action happens. So now Pranamaya is folded in. Then Manomaya is required, because the Vyapara is done by the Manas. The interaction with the external world is always done only by Manas. Manas gives instruction for Karmendriyas and Jnanendriyas. So Manas is also folded in, which is the Manomaya Kosha. Now Vijnanamaya Kosha drives everything with knowledge. So all the four koshas are now folded into Vijnanamaya Kosha. Now Anandamaya Kosha says, you do the work, the result comes after that, so there is something bigger than that. So I will now usurp that role also. So all the five koshas are folded into. This is how the personality is slowly developed in this Pancha Kosha that we see in Taittiriya Upanishad. So we will see how the Shruti talks about Anandamaya, which is the last layer in this discussion. Tasmadva etasmad vijnanamayat anyontara atmanandamayah tenaisha purnah sava esha purusha vidha eva tasya purusha vidhatam anvayam purusha vidah. Same formula. All the five mantras are repeating. This part is simply repeating. We are only replacing it a little bit. So he says, tasmatva, etasmatva, so from this previous one, which is Vijnanamaya, something different from that, because it's a Panchama Vibhakti, Apadana, so it is something different from that. Different from what I have discussed so far, which is Vijnanamaya, he says, anyaha, antara atma, there is something inner, something even more subtler. Inner indicates, inner is a figurative usage for subtle. Something which is inside. Inside this Vijnanamaya Kosha, Anya Antara Atma, and that is called Anandamaya. So that is the Anandamaya. That's the fifth layer of the personality that every one of us have. Tena Yesha Purnaha. So this Vijnanamaya Atma has become a Kosha now. That is the argument in Taittiriya Upanishad. First you understand it as Atma, deeply contemplate, and see that it is not an Atma, so it becomes an Kosha now. It becomes a layer. Now you introduce another Atma. So the Kosha is filled, like filling air into a bottle. So the Anandamaya, the Annamaya is the first layer. Everything is filled into it. Right? Now that is not something wrong. Because every cell, 6 billion cells in everyone's body, actually has the sense of I. When it comes to Kartritva and Bhoktritva, it has. You take a small needle and touch in the tip of my toe, I feel the eye as much as I would feel if you take a big rod and hit me. It is not directly proportional to a square meter or diameter or nothing. So that is why it is all filling inside. It's subtle. It is ambivalent. It is available everywhere in this Annamaya. So they first took the Annamaya as a mold and started pouring inside. One layer after the other. That's why it says, Tena Yesha Purnaha. This is filled by that. Anandamaya is now filling a layer called Vijnanamaya. Just like filling, molten liquid into a mold. Yeah? Sava Yesha Purusha Vida Eva. This is exactly like that Purusha only. Because you have filled it into the same thing. So it takes the same shape. It looks very similar. So it says it is exactly like the previous one. Tasya Purusha Vidatam. Like all that you found, the properties that you found, which means if Annamaya was 6 feet 1 inch, then Anandamaya is also 6 feet 1 inch, because it is filling there only. It's only becoming subtler and subtler. So tasya purusha vidatam anu ayam purusha vidaha. It follows the same argument we said early. Anu ayam purusha. Purusha Vidaha. So this mantra is repeating in all the four. So we are not. Now let us look at the proverbial bird form for this. Tasya priyame vashiraha modo dakshinaf pakshaha pramoda uttaraf pakshaha ananda atma brahma puccham pratishtha tadapyesha shloko bhavati. So now it has brought that typical bird structure. So Anandamaya, how do you describe Anandamaya? It says tasya Anandamayasya priyam eva shiraha, its head is priyam. That's what it says. Modo dakshina pakshaha, the right side, the right wing of the bird, equivalent of the bird, is the moda. And pramoda uttara pakshaha, the pramoda is the left wing, okay? Ananda atma, the trunk, the main piece of the bird is ananda. And the support for all these, pucham, the tail or the support, is Brahman. The, you know, Nirguna Visesha Brahman. That is the Brahma Pucham Pratishta, Tadapyesha Shloko Bhavati. So that is what it is actually now given as the next metaphorical description of this layer. So there are four words here which are all similar words. No, the Ayushankara's Bhashya has nice ways of differentiating all these. That's why these Bhashyas are very good. So anyway, it says priyameva shiraha. So the question is, what is this priyam? And what is this moda? And what is this pramoda? And then ananda. There are four of them there. So let us look at a little bit of what it is actually trying to. Okay, so first is priyam, priyam eva shiraha. So throughout Shankara Bhashya, and we have seen earlier also, that which is pradhanya, that we are able to easily see, without effort we are able to see, is something which we are able to easily relate to. So what he gives three definitions for priyam, moda and pramoda. I'll just say, I verbatim pulled out of his Bhashya. I'll just say what he said, then we will try to. He says, when it defines priyam, he says, ishta putradi darshana jam priyam. The most important thing is ishta darshana jam priyam. Okay, I first read it and then I'll explain it a little bit more. That is how he defines priyam. Now, what is moda? Moda is priya labha nimitta harshaha modaha. This is the second definition he gives. Okay. Third, he says prakrishta harshaha pramodaha. So these are the three definitions. Let's explain, understand these definitions. First, he says ishta putradi darshana jam priyam. He says something which we see what we like the most. There is a certain kind of joy that comes to us. Moment we see, for example, I like laddu so much. We'll start from simple example. Let's say I love laddu. Let's start there. The sight of the laddu gives me the first trace of ananda. Please understand. First measure of ananda. I love laddu. So moment you put a plate of laddu here, priya darshana jam. Jam is, you know, it generates. Janma, you know, it creates that ananda. So he said ishta putradi. He has added putradi. Because everybody likes their children, so that's why he is adding that. And adi has put dot dot etal. So he says anything ishta that we see. I have not still taken the laddu in my hands. I love laddu, and then good fortune you brought some laddu today. So I have now, you know, first level of happiness has come. This is a very obvious, easy way of defining. That's why it's priyameva shiraha. It's a very pradhanya visheha. So that is his first definition. Ishta putradi darshana jam priyam. Now what happens is, I am able to get my laddu. Sometimes laddu goes. You do a naivedya and take the laddu and go. Then my joy is over. That's the end of the story. Now if I can graduate to the second level, The second level is the laddu is in my hand now. I have got it. First I saw it. Seeing gives me a certain kind of joy. Getting it is takes me to the next measure of joy. Right? That's why he said, Priya Labha Nimitta Harshaha. I am now more or less sure that I am going to eat the laddu now. So what I liked, there is a labha of that. Labdham abhavati, tasmad labha. Tasya labdha labha. It's a taddita actually, so it's a labha. So I have got what I liked. That gives me the next level of joy. And harshaha, harshaha is that, you know, that energy, positive energy which goes even more. So that is what he defines as moda. Then of course the third definition is, he says, prakrishtaha harshaha. This joy is even more greater. That will happen when I have consumed the laddu. If I go by this analogy, so there are three things now. The three things are, I like something. The sight of what I like gives me a certain kind of joy. Okay? Getting that is the second measure of joy. Consuming it is the third measure of joy. It's not necessarily with laddu. I do MBA here. All my students will be doing only that. I do MBA here because I am going to get that consulting job, which is going to give me some 40 lakhs, 70 lakhs, 60 lakhs, whatever, whatever. Or I am become an investment banker. Now these people have come up for the, you know, interview. Day zero, I am shortlisted, I am sitting in the interview. That is called Priyadarshana Labha. According to this definition we have to use, I am almost at a striking distance now. Now, what I am trying to say is these ideas are very universal. That's why I am taking another weird example which doesn't involve any material. Conceptually, they are true. That's why I am bringing something which is not material in that sense. So, I am in the striking distance. There is a certain joy. Correct? And then I got the appointment. The interview is over. He said, you are selected. And then you give an appointment order. I get another type of joy. Third joy is I started buying a 250 breakers for. And I started going to the office also. Anyway. So, the point is. So basically what it is saying is this enjoyment that we are talking about, the Shruti is actually putting it into different layers. It is only putting it into three layers. What it says is, there is something very interesting which we have to reflect on, and that is all these enjoyments are actually short-lived. They are graded, they are constrained, and they are limited. Because the laddu, first laddu, okay, second laddu, maybe third laddu, I let go to the doctor. So it is a pain, not enjoyment anymore. So it is limited. It is graded, it is constrained, it is limited. That is why in Shankara Bhashya, what he says is, there is this mayat. There is a pratyaya called mayat. Ananda with a pratyaya called mayat pratyaya. Mayat pratyaya has two meaning. Okay, in Shankara Bhashya, he says, vikararte mayat. He says, that vikara is something which is constrained or limited. That is one of the meaning. So what it is trying to suggest, ananda is different from ananda maya. There are two definitions for maya. One maya is, it is just that and nothing more. I have been bringing that definition. But there is another meaning for mayat. As a pratyaya, it is called vikararte mayat. He says that all these anandamaya cannot be ananda. It is anandamaya, which is graded, constrained, limited, but still there are its own layers are there. So you have priya, you have moda, and you have pramoda. And now he says ananda atma. He says all these different types of ananda different types of joy that we are talking about are a certain shade of an inherent property called ananda. These are all ananda maya, that is ananda. There is this ananda as an idea is limitless, it is unconstrained, and these manifestations that we are seeing, that technical words used, you know, moda and pramoda and priyam, are only to say that this layer is only an anandamaya layer. If you scratch and go, you will see ananda. The atma is nothing but ananda, which is unconstrained, which is unlimited. Satyam Jnanam Anantam, from that, with that you can put Anandam also. Satchidananda is what you, Sat, Chit and Ananda in another way we may say. So it only tries to suggest that all these Anandamaya Kosha that you have are here, the Maya, Mayat Pratyaya is Vikararte. It only gives you temporary kind of coming and going. They are not permanent. But all of them are different manifestations of a concept called Ananda. That's why Ananda Atma. And then he says Brahma Pucham. The source of all sorts of Ananda that ever one can imagine. Constrained, unconstrained, limited, unlimited. All of them are from Brahman. That is the ultimate source from which all of them can manifest. All different kinds of Ananda that you can talk about. The source, the ultimate source is Brahman. So that is the support for this last layer that we are talking about, Brahma Pucham. Again, as I was telling you, Brahma Pucham is, Brahman is Satyam Jnanam Anantam. That's how the whole thing started in Brahmanandavalli. Brahmavit Apnoti Param. Whole teaching is over. Brahmanandavalli is only half a sentence. The rest are all trying to explain it in great detail. Brahmavit Apnoti Param. One who understood Brahmavit Apnoti Param gets everything. To explain it only, all these are going on. And that Brahman is Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Yoveda Nihitam Guhayam Parame Vyoman. That which is available everywhere. So as that's why he said, when things become very subtler, you cannot own, you cannot say it is mine. If air I cannot say, how can I say for God particle? I cannot say my God particle and your God particle. That is not possible. That's why Brahma Pucham, that's why the last three koshas that you see here, that is taking us to, it is connecting us to the larger principle, because it is getting subtler. In it getting subtler, we need to connect to a larger principle. It is very difficult to segregate it and put it. The Mahakasha is manifesting as Gadakasha. There is no way we can actually separate it. You remove the Upadhi, it becomes Mahakasha. So that is being reminded by this bird structure. So Anandamaya Kosha, proverbially in the sacrificial bird, is explained with the head, right wing, left wing, the trunk and the tail, as it did for the all the other four. So there is a Upasana Pala. We will not get into it now. I will just...
Tail, why is Brahman used? Tail, why is it represented by
Brahman? See, if you go to the... I described this in some detail in the first Annamaya Kosha. See, if you take a bird... See, the Shruti and most of the ancient Indian wisdom is very metaphorical. They explain it in a particular way. Sukshma is very important. You can't use the stula because it will take us nowhere. So if you look at a bird, the argument that was made was the support for the bird is the tail.
It cannot fly.
The support for the bird is the tail. Support for the airplane is also the tail in some sense. And the navigation is the two wings. The support is the tail, okay?
It's like substratum.
It is like that adhishtana. It is like that kutastha. It is the adhishtana. That is what we discussed. So the same thing will apply. We are only changing the colors.
Anvil.
Kutastha. So that's the support. And that is why it is saying this is a support. And then there is a short upasana. I will just read it. We will see it in the next class. I will just read that mantra.
Ananda. And
in other words, the different shades of joy. See, joy is an inherent divine property. The notion of joy is an inherent divine property. So whatever is the traces of joy, these are all different types of joys. As I told you, seeing laddu is one kind of joy, eating is another kind of joy, and then relishing that eating process is another kind of joy. It is saying all of them are coming from this fundamental concept called Ananda. And they are Ananda Maya. The Mayat says Vikararte Mayat. They are all limited, constrained, temporary, fleeting, all those. That's how. Then it ends with that short mantra which we will see in the next class. I will just recite the mantra, but we will see it in the next class. असन्नेव स भवति अस्ति ब्रह्मेति चेत् वेद चेत् अस्ति ब्रह्मेति चेत् वेद संतमेनं ततो विदुरिति तस्यैष एव शरीर आत्मा यपूर्वस्य सो इट सेज दिस आनंद आत्मा इज नाउ इनसाइड द आनंदमय लाइक दैट इट कंक्लूड्स इट टेक्स अस टू द एपिसेंटर Then there is a wonderful description. After this, some wonderful description about Ananda. It's called Ananda only or Brahmananda only because of that. So a wonderful discussion about the creation process, and then it takes a unit of happiness for a person, and then 10^2, 10^2, 21 levels it goes. Nice descriptions are there, and then 11 times it goes. And then finally, the how a person who has actually realized that atma, ananda will cross all these koshas. That's how the Shruti ends in this chapter. The rest of them are there. We'll complete this and then we look at some of those issues. Some interesting ideas are there. Okay.
10^22. Square, square,
square. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, can you? No, basically what it does is it takes a unit of happiness. Vittasya purna syat, adrishto adrishto. You are very healthy, you have a lot of money, you have a whole stretch of land, still it starts.